Cato Institute is a nonprofit educational institution, a think tank. Our guiding principles are individual liberty, free markets, limited constitutional government, peace among nations. Cato doesn't sign documents, but as a person, I could easily sign the Utah Compact. I thought that touched a lot of bases. What I want to cover in my time today is I want to talk about why these low-skilled immigrants come here, why they come here illegally, what we should do about it, and why SB 1070 and a lot of the rhetoric coming out of certain people in Arizona is not the way to go.
Just to boil it all down, the answer to illegal immigration is not to criminalize honest work. It's to change our federal law so that it is in harmony with our needs and our values as a nation. And right now, it is in conflict. Why do they come? It's the same reason our ancestors came 100 years ago. Opportunity, jobs, freedom. Got economics training, I tend to see things in terms of demand and supply, and it isn't much more complicated than that. We have ongoing demand for these workers. We're coming out of a recession, but in normal times, we're creating hundreds of thousands of jobs, net jobs each year in this country that require relatively few skills, just on-the-job training. And at the same time, the supply of Americans who've traditionally filled those jobs has been shrinking. It's a demographic story. We're getting older. We're getting better educated. Basically, these low-skilled immigrants take jobs that were filled by Americans without a high school diploma. And if you went back 50 years ago, half of Americans in the workforce did not have a high school diploma. Today, it's under 10%. 3 million fewer of those individuals today than 10 years ago. There's going to be 2 or 3 million fewer a decade from now. There's going to be close to 1 million fewer 16 to 24-year-olds. There just aren't enough native-born Americans to do these jobs, and we all know what these jobs are. Why do they come illegally? Well, Alex spelled it out this morning. They can't come legally. It isn't even a green card. We don't even have a temporary worker program that's anywhere near sufficient for these workers to come into the country. We have the H-2A program and the H-2B programs. They're overly bureaucratic. They're for seasonal workers only. They're totally inadequate for the labor needs of our country. And so what do these people do from Mexico and Central America? They come in illegally. We have this 2,000-mile border. They know there's work here. We have tried a policy of enforcement only, and it's failed. Spending is up 700%, five times as many agents at the border, 700 miles of this ugly fence that isn't doing any good. Programs like E-Verify, and Alex spelled out some of the problems with that. And by the way, it's encouraging that 17 conservative Tea Party affiliated groups wrote to Lamar Smith a couple of weeks ago, spelling out problems they had with E-Verify, including threats to civil liberties and the burdens on small business that this will pose. Isn't it interesting that a lot of our conservative Republican friends who seem to understand free markets and free enterprise are so ready to impose new burdens on small business? 30 or 40 years ago, when we had a kind of don't ask, don't tell policy about illegal immigration, 80% of them would eventually go back home. Mexico's their home, they want to go back. And now we've basically stranded them. The only answer, and I am one of the leading voices in Washington in saying this, I wish we were making more progress, it's comprehensive immigration reform. And I think your former governor, now Homeland Security Secretary Napolitano, had it right. She said it's a three-legged stool and you need all three legs for it to work. You need a robust temporary worker program to accommodate the future labor force needs of our country. We have to do something to legalize the 11 million who are already here. We're not going to deport them except at great economic and human cost. And then you have to have smart enforcement against people still operating outside the law. People in Washington like to point back to the 1986 Immigration Reform and Control Act. They say, we tried amnesty, we're not going to get fooled again. Well, that was missing one of the legs. There was no provision in the 1986 law for future flows. We had a one-time amnesty, 2.7 million, promises of enforcement, employer sanctions and all that. It predictably failed because we didn't address the fundamental underlying demographic and economic needs of our country for these low-skilled workers. We know from experience that if you offer sufficient opportunities for legal immigration, illegal immigration will drop dramatically. These folks may not be well-educated, but they're not stupid. If you give them a legal channel to enter the country, they'll come on a bus across a normal port of entry. They won't give their money to smugglers and risk their life in the desert. They'll gladly pay a fee to the government. We'd all be better off. They can live an above-ground existence here in the United States, enjoying the responsibilities and the privileges of living in the rule of law. That is what we should do. You also hear it, and I've heard it at the Republican primary debates, we need to get control of the border first. This is a ludicrous, nonsensical position. Why can't we do both? I have paid attention to the SB 1070 debate, and a lot of what motivated that legislation was based on fallacies. One is the cost of illegal immigration. Let's be upfront. There are costs to illegal immigration, not because it's illegal, not because it's immigration, but because these are low-skilled workers. And our system is just designed so that low-skilled workers don't pay income tax. It's not that they consume a lot more in government services, but they don't pay as much in taxes as the rest. For example, health care. The typical low-skilled immigrant is a healthy male in his 20s. He's not going to need a lot of medical care, and they don't use a lot of medical care. I cite a RAND study from a couple of years ago that shows that uncompensated care to illegal immigrants is 2% of the total. That's less than their share of the population. Schools. Yes, there are children of illegal immigrants in America's schools, but did you know that if you went back to 1970, when baby boomers like me were going through the system, one out of four Arizona residents was in a K-12 public school. Today it's one out of six. That school-age population is a lot smaller, despite the immigration. Crime's another one. A crime wave, and you hear these shocking stories, and we may hear one in a moment. But did you know this about crime in Arizona? The violent crime rate in Arizona is 23% lower than it was 10 years ago. Nationally, it's 20% lower, so you've made even more progress here. And that is at a time of, in those 10 years, of rising low-skilled illegal immigration. The crime rate in Arizona is the lowest it has been in 40 years. You can't blame a crime wave on low-skilled immigrants because you don't have a crime wave. Finally, jobs. I've testified a couple of times this year in January before Lamar Smith and his Judiciary Committee in the House, and I was in Pennsylvania a couple of months ago. Their legislature is considering an Arizona-type bill. I told them that's not the way to go. But let's just think of jobs for a moment. These low-skilled immigrants do not compete head-to-head with the vast majority of American workers. They complement American workers. We published a study at Cato a couple of years ago by Dixon and Rimmer that showed there were significant income gains to Arizona and American households from low-skilled immigration. Why? Well, first, if you have a legalization, you can take that money that's going to the coyotes and the government collect it as fees, and we get lower priced goods and services. Secondly, it stimulates investment. You get more investment, and that's more tax money for the government. And then finally, you get more middle-class jobs for Americans. When you have low-skilled workers coming in, these sectors can expand. They hire managers, they hire accountants. Americans that might have been doing these low-end jobs because of the language skills, the familiarity with the culture, they can become managers or supervisors or things like that. We are better off. And of course, in Arizona, you've had an economic whipsaw. Not because of immigrants, but because of the housing bust and federal policies, as I would argue at Cato. But you know, since the 1990s into the first decade of the 2000s, your unemployment rate was trending down pretty significantly at a time when low-skilled illegal immigration was going up. Of course, the two are connected. You've got jobs, the immigrants come. In the last 3 years, you've had a housing bust. Your unemployment went from under 4% to over 9%, while the illegal immigrant population was dropping by 100,000. I don't think it's got so much to do with your legislation as it does with the economy. So there's nationally and on a state level, there is no connection between incoming immigration and rising unemployment. In fact, the correlation is the opposite. Immigrants come in when the unemployment rate is low because they respond to that market signal. When you chase immigrants out of your state, those are fewer people who rent houses, who buy food, and low-skilled illegal immigrants pay taxes. More than half of them pay Social Security taxes. The Social Security system is sitting on $100 to $200 billion paid in by these workers that they'll never pay out. They pay sales taxes, they pay property taxes when they rent. The E-Verify program and other enforcement, it hasn't so much chased them out as pushed them further underground, where they're in the underground economy and they're paying even fewer taxes. You have an important agricultural sector here. Georgia and Alabama are discovering that when you chase these low-skilled workers out, it hurts your agricultural sector. I think laws should fix problems. I think SB 1070 is an exercise in empty symbolism, in fact, self-destructive symbolism. It's not going to revive your housing market, it won't lower the crime rate, it won't boost the state's economy, it won't create a single job except maybe for lawyers and some police officers enforcing it. There is a better way. It's comprehensive immigration reform. I urge you all to go to the Cato website, www.cato.org. Thank you very much.